And now, the Sci-Fi Channel original special, The New Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed.
At the Greater Pittsburgh Airport, definitely confirm the fact that there was an object in the sky 13 minutes before 5.
December 9, 1965. Fiery object blazes a path from Canada down through Ohio and Pennsylvania and lands in the foothills of the Allegheny Mountains.
I think whatever it was that landed in Kecksburg was something from a different planet.
You could actually see where, you know, something had come through the treetops and where it hit the ground.
I heard a scream that came from the wooded area. I never wanted to hear a scream like that again.
Just what was it that crashed, or some say landed, in Kecksburg, Pennsylvania?
That night really stuck in my mind, because I know what I saw. And nobody's going to tell me anything different.
And why did the U.S. military try to cover it up?
I believe that the government threatened them if they said anything.
He had the gun up at us immediately. He was pointing it right at us and said, stop, get out of here.
You're going to bump into the presence of the U.S. military in all of this.
A team of top scientists will try to unravel a mystery that's lingered for over 35 years.
Okay, it does look like the top of that tree was hit by something.
And has torn a simple all-American town apart.
The government has been lying to us.
That's all BS.
It sounds like gooey to me.
Relatives who were very close together, now all of a sudden they are on different sides because one said I was involved, the other one said nothing happened.
I think people deny because they don't want to accept the truth about a lot of things.
Sci-Fi will also return to Roswell to analyze what could be tangible proof of a crashed UFO. I'm Bryant Gumbel. Welcome to the New Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed. Roswell has been called the granddaddy of all UFO cases, and for good reason. It has a number of credible witnesses and all the signs of a government cover-up. While the Sci-Fi Channel continues its investigation into the Roswell crash with some intriguing new discoveries, the channel has also launched new inquiries into other controversial UFO cases. During this program, we'll apply the tools of modern science and the powers of the U.S. Constitution to search for evidence of what really happened in a little town called Kecksburg, known to some as Pennsylvania's Roswell. December 9, 1965. According to the now declassified military Project Blue Book, a three-man military team was dispatched to this sleepy little town that night. Their assignment? To recover an unidentified flying object that caused a small fire in a remote patch of woods. If you believe the authorized report, the men searched until 2 a.m., but found nothing. The object was later explained as a meteor passing over the area. That's where the official story ends, and the controversy begins.
I am free to my own opinion, and my opinion is I seen an outer space craft hit the ground.
I think it's just a made-up story for television.
I really can't answer why some people are denying this happened. I know it happened. I can't answer for anybody else.
Since the strange and unsettling events of December 9, 1965, this rural village, just 25 miles southwest of Pittsburgh, has been a town divided. There are those who claim something otherworldly happened here, and others who insist it was all an elaborate hoax.
Some witnesses who went public, they are accused of lying or making up the story. Relatives who were very close together, now all of a sudden they were on different sides because one said I was involved, the other one said nothing happened. There still is a lot of emotion with certain individuals over the reality of this event.
In 1990, the television show Unsolved Mysteries filmed a reenactment of the so-called Kecksburg UFO incident. Some townspeople saved this prop UFO, nicknamed the Acorn, and mounted it outside the old fire hall. For many, it's a sore reminder of a wound that refuses to heal.
A lot of the parents of the children that were around there do not talk about it. It's a very hush-hush situation, and they have a hard time communicating with other people that think that it is real.
I think that whole UFO thing would have, you know, brought just a lot of attention, and I don't think the older generation like that.
I'm 25 years old, and a lot of people my age think that something did come down, and just nobody really knows the truth about it.
Through the years, it has puzzled me what came down, and I really would like to know. Some, you know, say it was a UFO, some say it was a meteor. Who really knows except for the government?
Though Robert Blystone was only 16 in 1965, he's still struggling to make sense of what he witnessed at about a quarter of five one unseasonably warm December evening.
I just got home from school. It was warm, so I figured I'd come out on the porch for a while. I was kind of looking over this way. I heard this like humming or a hissing type noise, and I looked up and here was this object going by. It was like a fireball, and it had vapors of different colors coming out from behind it. You could see where it was descending, but it was going very slow. It did not fall. It was controlled. And when it hit, you could see all this smoke, dust coming up.
Blystone was just one of thousands who witnessed the so-called fireball over the North American skies. Less than an hour earlier, the airborne object had been tracked as far north as Canada, leaving in its wake jammed phone lines and stunned onlookers.
Kecksburg is really one of the great unknown UFO crashes in American history. The Kecksburg case is very interesting. It has a very high degree of corroboration among the various witnesses. And the story that they tell appears to be one in which you have this object that streaked across Canada and Ohio, slammed into Kecksburg, Pennsylvania. You have an object that was moving far too slowly to be a meteor.
Well, I know what I saw, and it definitely wasn't a meteor, but it certainly seemed to be a constructed thing. Had smooth edges and smooth lines and didn't appear to be a meteor at all to me.
It appears, in the opinion of some of the witnesses, to have maneuvered, that has changed course. That's an interesting dimension to it.
Over the greater Pittsburgh area, there were many reports of this bright object. The object continued to move southeast into Westmoreland County. There was a loud sonic boom. It shook the area as it passed over. Between Greensburg and Latrobe, the object made a turn to the south. And at Laurelville, there are other witnesses up in that general area that saw the object now moving towards roughly northeast into Kecksburg. It appears as though it may have been slowing itself down.
In nearby Greensburg, all hell was breaking loose. Scores of frantic witnesses called in to local radio station WHJB to report the strange object. It was just before five, and WHJB office manager Mabel Mazza was getting ready to leave for the night. She wouldn't make it home till well past midnight.
The disc jockey that was on duty at the time, Stan Wall, came back and asked me to please help him to take those phones. I said, "What's that noise?" He said, "That's the phones."
I seen two big bright flashes and a long streak of orange light. Come down out of the clouds. My daughter and I both saw it at the same time.
And I'm talking about there were hundreds of calls. Of course, they said something landed in Kecksburg, and then somebody else said it was a UFO, and of course I thought, yeah, you know.
One call stood out. It was from a Kecksburg homemaker named Frances Kelp. Mrs. Kelp told WHJB News Director John Murphy that the mysterious fireball was a bright object that looked like a four-pointed star. In a later radio report, Murphy recalled his conversation with Frances Kelp and its chilling significance.
After listening to many such calls through the past years, it's fairly easy to tell by the tone in a person's voice whether they believe what they're saying or whether it's a prank call. This woman to me sounded like she believed and was sincere over what she was saying. This was the first piece of actual evidence we had in the early evening. Up until now, it was lights in the sky and things are going to be checked out. Now we had something physical. We had an object on the ground.
After hearing Mrs. Kelp's story, Murphy set out to find the mysterious object. The seasoned reporter had no idea of the dangers into which this story would lead him. 5 miles away, in Kecksburg, the state police had already arrived, along with a few local volunteer fire departments. They had their hands full, trying to control the growing crowd of curious onlookers lining the country lanes. Among those straining to get a closer look was Bill Weaver.
I was 19 years old. I heard about it on the radio. I was coming down the hill. This is the farm road that we come in on that night. And we stopped here on this road and we looked down into the field. And we did see something down in the underbrush, in the trees. There was a light glowing, a blue light, much like a welder's light that comes real bright and then goes dull. And that happened back and forth quite a few times.
It was shortly after dark when WHJB's John Murphy arrived at the Kecksburg site. Though he claims he didn't see the arcing light himself, he recorded several witnesses on the scene who described it, including one state trooper.
One of the state police officers walked up to my car and said, "We got something out there. It's blue, it's pulsating, and there's a light on it." To the best of our knowledge, there was no one in the woods at that time. Several people, including Adam Lintz from Channel 11 television, said he saw a light.
But despite dozens of concurrent witness reports, some Kecksburg residents bitterly contend that the light had a simple explanation.
There were a few people down in the woods looking around because it was nighttime, see? Every once in a while, somebody would see a flashlight and they'd say, "See there, there's something blinking down there."
We found out later that it was a young fellow that had a strobe camera, they called it, and he flashed it 3 times. And that's where they got the blue light. And that ended that.
Ed Myers was the chief of the volunteer fire squad at the time of the incident.
But that was me, I guess. They claim that come down. It's supposed to be like an egg horn. Well, it's supposed to scorch the ground, they said. There was no ground disturbed back there. Did you see any ground?
No ground disturbed.
Galen Wilkins is also a lifelong Kecksburg fireman. Both of them are adamant that nothing at all happened in their town that night.
50th anniversary of 1939 and 1989 of the fire department, you know, see nothing about a UFO in that.
Nothing in there either.
Kecksburg was a small, they called it a village, a lot of them, and it was friendly. This incident changed a lot of things when they come out with this UFO story. It changed that town completely.
Pretty bad that it's broken and divided some of the people that have been neighbors here all their lives. I cannot believe that they would lie to me on this, you know. I just can't believe they would.
Well, I'm not going to call them liars, but I think that people just say stuff to get on TV. I think, you know, when the camera starts rolling, people say anything if they think you're going to put them on a show.
If people are saying that nothing happened that night, I look at it in two ways. One, either they weren't here, or two, they're lying. Because I was here, and I seen it, myself and a lot of other people.
I would say to the people of Kecksburg that believe that nothing crash-landed that night and that nothing happened, I think they need to rethink what they're saying. Maybe they've heard too many stories about men in black coats from the government type of thing. And some folks are just plain scared.
Those who knew newsman John Murphy claim he wasn't scared by much of anything. That was before he got involved in the Kecksburg incident. These rare audio recordings are the actual tapes he made on the scene that night. This is the first time they've ever been nationally broadcast.
When I got to the top of the dome where they pointed out to me, said that was the description the woman gave of where she saw the object, there was no smoke there at that time. flight.
Guess who got her star on fire?
A star on fire? Can you point out what part of the wood you saw it in?
Right down there.
Sensing he was on to something, Murphy called the station to give office manager Mabel Mazza an update.
And he called me on the CB radio. He said, "We got a big one, kid."
But Mabel received another call that night, one that would prove even more significant.
It was about an hour into the phone calls. Then people called me on the phone and said that they were from the military. They wanted directions to where this thing had landed in Kecksburg.
Coming up on the new Roswell, Kecksburg exposed.
He had the gun up at us immediately. He was pointing it right at us and said, "Stop, get out of here."
Did someone threaten the lives of ordinary Kecksburg citizens? President Clinton's former chief of staff wants to know.
Holding people at gunpoint is not the ordinary way we do business in this country.
Kecksburg eyewitnesses lead a science team into the forest, searching for physical clues to what might have fallen there in 1965. And a surprising new update from the Roswell dig.
We are digging holes in the ground to look for physical evidence of an extraterrestrial vessel impact.
The new Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed, will return in a moment.
The new Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed, is sponsored by Sonicare Elite. Stop rushing, start Sonicare. And by CDW, the right technology right away.
At CDW, account managers help you choose the IT products right for you. So we read a lot of product manuals.
Open.
They're great. My husband likes spy novels, but give me a modular access router manual any day. Then Mama Bear routes the frame directly to the switch port. I love the way this one ends.
For account managers who know all about the IT products you need, you can always expect more from CDW.
The new Sonicare Elite by Philips. With patented sonic technology, its bristle tips move 3 times faster for a deep cleaning experience unlike any other.
For whiter teeth and healthier gums,
stop brushing. Start Sonicare.
Oh, where's Mommy?
She's sick in bed. Come on, we gotta get you ready.
Forecast for today is continued snowfall.
Is it?
Now, which one of these?
Yes.
How about your brother?
Looks great. Come on, let's go, let's go.
Here's your coats. See you after school, guys.
Who would replace you if you got the flu? Before you get the flu, ask about new Flu Mist, the first nasal flu vaccine for healthy adults and children ages 5 to 49. Flu Mist helps prevent the flu for the entire season. Flu Mist should not be used in anyone allergic to any vaccine component, including eggs, in children 5 to 17 on aspirin therapy, in pregnant women or in people with certain medical conditions, immune system disorders, asthma or reactive airway disease. In studies, runny nose was the most common side effect. Others included headache, cough, and irritability. Side effects not seen in studies are possible when Flu Mist is used in a larger population. Ask your healthcare professional about new Flu Mist before the flu hits you.
There are over 3 dozen muscles in the human jaw. When hunger strikes, you'll be glad you have every last one of them. Triscuit. Definitely not for nibblers.
Shipping durability testing. Electrostatic surge simulation. Extreme environment performance analysis.
Hey, hey!
Structural integrity. You name it, we do it. Over 11,000 hours of internal and external testing per Dell model.
Harsh.
But effective.
Right, that's why Dell is one rock solid, reliable PC.
Can you imagine?
You have no idea.
Call Dell today for great deals. Right now, a Dimension desktop with an Intel Pentium 4 processor is just $599 after mail-in rebate. Plus, for a limited time, get a free CD burner upgrade. Inspiron notebooks are just $899.
And now over here, the torsion chamber.
Rock solid PCs. Easy as Dell. Dell PCs use Intel Pentium 4 processors.
This Halloween, prepare to freak out. First, experience magic unlike anything you've seen before when Chris Angel brings his brand of mind-blowing illusion to sci-fi in Chris Angel Supernatural. Then, Scare Tactics goes to the horror movies with an all-new special hosted by Shannon Doherty from Universal Studios. Halloween on Sci-Fi. Two all-new original specials. This Friday starting at 9 on Sci-Fi.
I've been having this dream every night for months. I'm convinced that there's some form of communication, and that can only mean one thing. Will I be in time to save the Earth?
Open your mind. Unlock the secret. Live the fantasy. For the first time on network television, the groundbreaking cinematic experience based on the best-selling video games, Final Fantasy, The Spirits Within, premieres this Saturday at 9 on Sci-Fi.
Many seasons have passed since a mysterious object came down in the black and tangled Pennsylvania woods, leaving unanswered questions that have torn the quiet town of Kecksburg apart. Dr. Stephen Kite, a geoarchaeologist from the University of West Virginia, and geology graduate students Mitzi Schramke and Chris Haney arrive in Kecksburg to begin a Sci-Fi Channel-sponsored investigation. They'll employ the tools of modern science to search for answers to this mystery.
I was excited about the opportunity to do the geoarchaeology of the site because it is so unusual. Certain sets of evidence would be expected if there was a large object that impacted here.
The location of the site is based on eyewitness testimony.
One more step.
Jim Romansky was a young volunteer fireman from a nearby town at the time of the incident. In the late 80s, he visited the site with UFO researcher Stan Gordon.
And he walked around that area for quite a while, and then he said, you know what, guys, I think we're right on the spot. A year later, we received a tip that there was another witness in the area that may have seen the object who had never reported it to us, and that was Bill Bullybush.
Today, 77-year-old Bullybush must again try and locate the spot where he saw the mysterious object so many years ago. The landscape has changed significantly since he was last here.
This is it, George. Here's the tree that I stood back of. And I stood here and I happened to look up there, and there it was. It was embedded right into the ground about a foot and a half.
Bullybush's description of the object supports the theory that it was probably not a meteorite.
I was working on a 64 Corvair at home. I happened to see this red ball of fire going across. It come up and went towards the mountain, just like if it was radio controlled. It made a figure eight, and it come right down in here and belly landed right in here, knocked the top of the trees out. It stunk like rotten eggs. You could smell it, you know, and then just like sizzling and like sparks come, just like if it was cooling off, it was red hot.
A fairly soft landing.
Oh yeah, it just like it was radio controlled.
Kite and company hope Bullybush's memories will help them determine what fell here in 1965. They'll scan the area for metallic debris and unusual radiation levels. Most importantly, they'll dig test pits looking for evidence of soil disruption. If there has been an impact here, or even a cover-up of one, this damp, mossy soil could still contain the evidence within its delicate layers. Farmer George Pacina is one of the landowners at the site where Kite and his team of scientists will be working. But he doesn't believe anything fell in his woods on the night of December 9, 1965.
I didn't see anything fall, nothing on that sort. They said it probably was a meteor that passed over.
There's no love lost between Bullybush and Covachina. They typify the two faces of the Kecksburg townspeople, those who believe something strange happened here and those who don't. If Kite's dig proves successful, It will be the first step in mending a rift that's lasted more than a quarter of a century. Consulting with Kite in that unique quest is none other than Dr. Bill Dolman of the University of New Mexico. Dolman oversaw last year's Sci-Fi Channel-sponsored dig at the Roswell debris field.
Bill Dolman and I talked by phone, and he gave me some pointers on what he did at his excavation or his work.
Dolman's 2002 excavation at Roswell ushered in a new era in the study of UFOs. The use of science to solve mysteries that were once thought to be science fiction.
The exciting part about this was that I went and I looked at this and I said, wow, we've got a stratigraphic anomaly right where there should be one.
What we have done is find some things that are suggestive, taken soil samples that could be looked at microscopically for some kind of debris evidence.
Today, Dolman returns to the Wells Fargo vault in Roswell to recover those precious soil samples and bags of hamuos, historic materials of uncertain origin, for further study. He will put the soil samples to the test in an Albuquerque lab to determine if they really could be remnants of an extraterrestrial crash.
The story goes that the military picked up all the debris, but everybody knows that there's always more little debris than there is big. The goal of these analyses was essentially to see if there's any microscopic material left over from whatever impacted there.
Can modern science unlock the secrets of UFO mysteries, or what some claim to be UFO myths? Later tonight on the New Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed. We head out to Kecksburg to try and mend some very battered fences.
There were jeeps, there were people with some kind of guns.
Military don't track meteors and arrive that fast.
They lie.
And more startling details of the Kecksburg crash and cover-up.
They had rifles at hip level. I heard a scream that came from the wooded area. I never wanted to hear a scream like that again.
We jump into uncharted space. Limited supplies, no allies, and now no hope. As of this moment, we are at war. I promise you one thing. We will make it.
Let's get the old girl ready to roll and kick some Cylon ass.
Battlestar Galactica premieres Monday, December 8th at 9, only on Sci-Fi. Winner of the 2003 Emmy Award for Outstanding Miniseries.
I'm ready to go with you now.
Steven Spielberg presents Taken, every Sunday at 9 on Sci-Fi. Sponsored by Gateway.
I have this house that's closing in on me. With three children, it feels tiny. When I try to find my ringing cell phone, suddenly it becomes cavernous. I miss every call.
Introducing Singular Fast Forward, a smart device that lets your incoming wireless calls automatically ring through to all your home phones. Best of all, the calls don't count against your wireless minutes.
I call it my thanks for making my life easier plan.
Fast Forward, another reason Singular fits you best.
New Dentine Fire. Ruby red shell outside. Intensely cinnamon inside. It sizzles. It's cinnamon. It's new Dentine Fire. Spark something.
Action!
Remember, when you hit the water,
I need you to hydroplane out of control.
Water!
Remember, out of control.
Cut!
No, cut!
Cut.
Fire the stunt driver.
The new Michelin Hydro Edge with patented hydro chutes. It's performing tire in its class. Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
Hey, where does this go? It does both.
Cleaner.
Fact. New Cling 2-in-1 cleans with every flush and fragrances even between flushes. New Cling 2-in-1, cleaning plus 24 hours of fragrance.
What if you had the power to change the future?
Those people, they shouldn't actually be dead.
By reliving the past.
What happened to them?
Neighbors heard a gunshot around 10.
For True Davies, it's not just a possibility.
Help me.
It's a calling.
She's alive. You're gonna die today, Rebecca.
What did you just say?
Eliza Dushku, True Calling, next week on Fox.
Around here, barbecue sauce is serious business. Ingredients like garlic and crushed oregano give a sauce its authentic flavor. First, they fire grill some chicken breast, some sweet peppers and onions, put it on some fresh baked bread with this great smoky barbecue sauce. Some of the best barbecue around here is at Burger King. Yeah, Burger King.
Flavor from fire grilling, not from fat. The new smoky barbecue chicken baguette from Burger King. Come on over, the fire's ready.
Would you like to own your own business and enjoy financial independence? Nationwide Cyber Systems introduces the most exciting business opportunity of the 21st century, the Wi-Fi Public Internet Terminal. This amazing machine offers high-speed internet access, email, and video email for only 25 cents per minute, payable by cash or credit card. The machine is also a wireless access point where up to 100 users at the same time can receive high-speed wireless internet service for only $3.95 an hour or $7.95 a day. Nationwide can start you in a turnkey business and help you secure the most profitable locations in your area before someone else gets them. You can start part-time and expand according to your own timetable. Call now for your free video and information package. There is unlimited income potential. Don't delay. The best locations won't last long.
December 9, 1965, Kecksburg, Pennsylvania. By 8 p.m., a bona fide mob had gathered, both on the small farm road called Hillen's Lane and on the opposite road, known as Meteor Road, since that very night. Many onlookers were out-of-towners, attracted to the area by sensational radio and television reports, like this never-before-aired recording of KDKA Radio's live call-in show, originally broadcast right as the UFO drama was unfolding.
This is Mike Levine of KDKA in Pittsburgh. I'm getting bulletins here by the minute. KDKA News is checking with the Pentagon, it's out in the open that there's a possibility an Army missile might have plunged into the Moore Building in Westmoreland County. Maybe not. But we've got a lot of speculation going on, and people are really demanding some explanations, and the government isn't coming up with it.
Perhaps the first reporter on the scene was the news director from another radio station, John Murphy of WHJB Greensburg. Frustrated by all the secrecy, Murphy began to pressure local state troopers for some answers.
I asked, did you find anything down there? He looked puzzled for a second and said, I'm not sure. Then I said, well, let me ask my question a different way. After you make your report to the captain, do you think you or the captain perhaps may have something to tell me?
Though Murphy had covered hard news for decades, he wasn't prepared for the state trooper's response.
He said, you better get your information from the Army. This was the first time anyone had made any mention of the military. To refer me to the Army led me to believe that perhaps there was something in the woods at that time that showed some significance of military value.
Bob Gaddy, a cub reporter for the Greensburg Tribune Review, was also on the scene.
There were a lot of military around. There were state police, and the military had weapons. I got out of my car, and they said, where are you going? I said, I'm going down. I want to see what's going on. They said, you can't go down. I said, why? They said, there's nothing there. And I said, well, if there's nothing there, why can't I go down? Guy said, you got to get out of here.
Years later, when Project Blue Book was declassified, the official report on Kecksburg stated that only three military personnel were dispatched to investigate the incident.
That report goes on to indicate that a three-man team had been dispatched from the Oakdale radar site in Pittsburgh, which had been an Air Force unit, and that nothing was found. And that's the only official document.
Having researched the Kecksburg incident for over 30 years, Stan Gordon smells a cover-up. He believes there may indeed have been a three-man team dispatched from the Oakdale radar site, but that they were only the front men for a larger military operation. Eyewitness testimony seems to back him up in this.
I'm talking about from here.
A lot of these people say, look, I was there, we saw the military. Some people say they saw Army and Air Force personnel. Others claim they saw NASA personnel on the scene that night.
Still, some respected Kecksburg citizens stand by the government story that there were no military at all in the rural village that December night.
I never seen any military people out here.
The military saying they weren't there, I find that hard to believe when a small community of a couple hundred people say they were there. And I would believe the community over the other stories any day.
There's no military trucks in that area at that time, no. No military jeeps, no nothing. No way, no way. I'd take a lie detector test on that.
Well, that's a big lie right there, because I'd swear to this on a stack of Bibles there that they were there, and I talked to them.
Bob Bittner was a volunteer fireman at the time of the incident. Many of his lifelong friends have cut him off because he refuses to change his story about what he remembers of that night. Bittner claims that on December 9th, 1965, he showed up in Kecksburg after working his day job as a trucker.
Now, here, three military vehicles came in. There was an officer there. He was a pretty highly ranked officer. I asked him if we could go down in there with him, and they said, nobody goes down in there with us.
Despite those, including the government, who deny a heavy military presence in Kecksburg that night, many others, including Linda and Bob Foscha, swear their little town was overrun by soldiers.
Did she tell you what color the smoke was?
He said it was white. My husband was watching the TV and also the radio, and they had reports of an object falling. And then we noticed there was an awful lot of traffic on our road outside of our home that leads to Kecksburg. There was a lot of police cars, ambulance, fire trucks. Then after a while, we saw a lot of military coming through.
The Foschas were stunned to see the military arrive in Kecksburg so soon after news of the crash.
I would say the nearest regular Army or Air Force base is about 50 miles away. So I'm assuming that they either came from the Pittsburgh area or flew into the Pittsburgh airport where they had an Air Force base and then drove out.
Or else they were tracking it and they were following it.
If the U.S. military had indeed been tracking the mysterious object on radar, that would explain their quick arrival. But it would contradict the official report that the fireball, seen by thousands, had simply been a meteorite that disintegrated before hitting Earth.
In terms of watching a meteorite coming in, meteorites, as a rule, don't show up much on radar because they are very small. They're usually fist or pebble sized. The radars we have even now can't see things that small.
The Kecksburg incident begs the question, what could have prompted the U.S. government to dispatch numerous vehicles and military personnel to a tiny farming town on an ordinary December night? If you believe the accounts of some eyewitnesses, one thing is certain. Whatever it was that landed in the woods that night, the military wasn't about to let anyone near it. As the night wore on, the commotion intensified. Out-of-towner David Newhouse, 19 at the time of the incident, has come back to Kecksburg for the first time since 1965 to recount his own unnerving run-in with the U.S. military.
This guaranteed the spot. Remember, we came around the turn and came up. I remember the high section. The reason we had stopped here was we saw the lights on the grove of woods, just like bright white lights from like floodlights or whatever. You could tell guys were in there working. Evidently, someone that saw us park here, and they were watching us as we were coming down through the field.
According to Newhouse, his foray into the woods abruptly came to a halt. Standing in front of him was an armed soldier.
certain things you never forget. First time I ever had a gun pointed at me, kind of hard to forget that. You know, definitely a rifle, straight up, right at me. And he got my attention. That guy was in the Army, and that was a military rifle. That was an M1 I was looking at. I was in the Army, I know what rifles are. I belong to the NRA, as you see my sticker on the back. I like guns, I don't like them pointed at me, though. So they told us to get, you know, out of here, and which we just turned around and came right back down the hill. We didn't question them.
After parking on the road overlooking the wooded ravine, teenager Bill Weaver had his own altercation with the military.
They come up and told us that we had to move our cars, we had to leave. Well, I was 19 years old at the time, and I wanted to know why I had to leave. They wouldn't give us a reason. All they told me was that they would confiscate my car if I didn't leave. Well, the car was in my father's name. So I figured I'd rather than cause a problem for myself, I left.
Don Sebastian was another young curiosity seeker. He, too, had been listening to WHJB and convinced a group of friends to drive the 45 miles to Kecksburg to see what the commotion was all about.
There were flares across the road. There were armed state police. One of them approached my vehicle and asked me to turn around and go back the way I had come. Being young and adventurous, of course, this wasn't sitting too well with me or my friends. It just didn't seem right to travel that distance and not get to see a little something, what's going on, you know.
Sebastian headed down into the woods on foot so that he could get a better look at what was going on.
I made my way up that road, got up behind this one truck, military truck. I managed to climb up on a bumper or a tire of the truck, I really can't recall which, but I know that I got enough height that I could see over. On the other side of the truck was armed military personnel. As I looked and observed down over an embankment and down into a ravine, I saw approximately 75 to 100 military personnel. They had rifles at hip level, and they were proceeding towards a wooded area, pretty much in step. Within about 10 minutes' time, I heard a scream that came from the wooded area. And that scream was such that it made the hair on the back of my neck stand up. I never wanted to hear a scream like that again.
Seconds later, Sebastian says he heard a second hair-raising scream.
I think it was way too much volume for a human. I don't see how a human could produce a scream that would carry a distance, you know, that type of a distance. And that second scream that did it for me, I says, that's it. I'm out of here.
What could have landed in the woods that night to cause such a chilling scream? What could have been of such national importance to cause armed soldiers to allegedly threaten law-abiding citizens? And why, so many years later, don't we yet have a satisfactory ending to this story? Coming up.
They were running the show. The people up there in suits and trench coats, they told the military and the state police what to do.
I believe that the government threatened them if they said anything.
Men in black and other shadowy figures.
There's no doubt that these men in black do exist, and at least some of them are, shall we say, from the world of officialdom.
And the search for the missing Kecksburg files.
If you're going to send out dozens and dozens of armed officials, there are records kept of such an event. We're convinced that the records must exist someplace.
When the new Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed, returns on the Sci-Fi Channel.
This Friday, Scare Tactics goes to the horror movies with an all-new special. Hosted by Shannon Doherty from Universal Studios. Halloween on Sci-Fi, the Scare Tactics Scaretacular. This Friday at 10. Get ready for the DVD event of the year.
Let's head in.
Unleash the beast. Unleash the excitement. Unleash the power that's too big for one DVD.
My
God.
The Hulk 2-Disc Special Edition. Unleash the groundbreaking special effects secrets. And go behind the scenes for a revealing look at the amazing technology that brought the Hulk to life. Just push play and you'll be blown away. Hulk. Buy it on DVD and video today.
Applebee's Take Two is back.
It takes two, baby. It takes two, baby. Make a dream come true.
Choose two of your favorite entrees for one mouth-watering plate. Eating good in the neighborhood.
Mankind's greatest invention? Fire was clever. The telephone. The automobile. And the DVD. But wouldn't it be great if you could record on this?
Presenting the Panasonic DVD recorder.
My shows, my home movies, even my photos.
The incomparable picture, sound, and ease of DVD. Now yours with total control recording to watch whatever, whenever you want.
Now this is genius.
The DVD recorder from Panasonic. Ideas for life.
That all you got?
Come on, man.
Going down. Yes!
It's 10 p.m. Do you know where your deodorant is? Next time, use new Power Stripe from Right Guard with a stripe of time-released odor fighters no other deodorant's got. Nothing looks like it, nothing works like it.
Yes!
Yeah. Right Guard, right to the end of the day.
New from Ricola, nature's protection with extra vitamin C. To help strengthen your immune system. Naturally.
Ricola.
Some opportunities are too good to pass up. The Nissan Sentra.
Snack comes in stacks. Introducing new Lay's Stacks potato crisps. Not just stackable, irresistible.
One for you, one for you, one for you. Ten for Lay's.
Hi, I'm Tanya Memmi, and I want to thank you for ranking DirecTV number one in customer satisfaction for the second year in a row. Cable and satellite customers responded to this study, and DirecTV was ranked the highest. This reflects our commitment to bringing you the best in service, value, and entertainment. Great employees and great customers are what set DirecTV apart from the competition. We're proud to have earned this number one ranking in customer satisfaction 2 years in a row.
Imagine having it all. The Total Choice Premier Package from DirecTV delivers over 195 channels of our best programming, including all of our premium services, HBO, Stars, Showtime, Cinemax, and Sports Pack. Get more movies, more sports, and the maximum entertainment variety with Total Choice Premier. Call 1-800-DIRECTV and order today.
In the summer of 2002, the Sci-Fi Channel sponsored an historic dig at the reputed site of the Roswell UFO crash. There, University of New Mexico contract archaeologist Dr. Bill Dolman discovered a gouge in the earth he believes could be evidence of a powerful impact. He also collected 55 soil samples and 27 historical materials of uncertain origin.
Okey-doke.
It's time to put those samples under a microscope at New Mexico's state-of-the-art Assegai Laboratories.
There were a number of mineral specimens that had an unusual shape. There were a number of things that looked to be probably of biological origin. And then there were a number of things that appeared to be, in some cases, are very obviously man-made.
While he waits for his results, Dolman has scientist Bill Biava do an elemental analysis on the soil samples he collected at the dig site.
to answer the question, is the dirt from Foster Ranch any different from the dirt not on Foster Ranch? The soil profiles on samples from the backhoe trench through the metal detection anomaly was pretty radically different.
The analysis of the soil elements convinces Dolman to plan future digs at Foster Ranch. In the meantime, on day two of the Kecksburg investigation, Dr. Ray Hicks arrives on the scene. A forestry specialist from West Virginia University, his mission is to see if the broken trees, which witnesses described after the incident, can still be detected years later. Hicks is aided by a set of rare photographs taken by researcher Stan Gordon in the early 80s, showing what appears to be tree damage.
Certainly you can see that something directional happened here. These trees are all pushed in a certain direction. Right here where we are, I'm having real difficulty matching up the trees that are falling with anything that I see here.
Dr. Hicks is faced with the impractical puzzle of identifying trees that were broken over 35 years ago from photos taken nearly 20 years ago.
You see? All right, as we're standing here right now, you see that tree right back there? It's a black cherry, actually. This tree right here is that dead one. You see where it's got the sprout coming out here? Okay, and you see at the top, you see where the top's broken out? Okay, so this tree is that one. I can say that with 90% surety that we found at least the trees that are represented in that picture.
Hicks updates geoarchaeologist Stephen Kite on his findings.
My assumption is that this tree here is the one that was affected. That is, that the top here was broken out.
That is consistent with Bill's recollection that it was coming in from this direction.
Okay, it was coming in from this direction, going that way.
There's only one problem. The trees Hicks has identified from the photos border a location in a different creek bed, parallel, but about 100 feet away from, the site where Bill Bullybush remembered seeing the crashed object.
This is Ray Hicks. I'm a forestry professor at West Virginia University. I'm here with Steve Kite.
The scientist phoned researcher Stan Gordon, who originally interviewed all the eyewitnesses.
When I talked to the scientists involved, it sounded like they were close to the area, but it sounded like to me that Bill may have possibly been at the wrong tree because some of the other things they described didn't line up.
Okay, so if we stand with our back to the tree facing the Hayes farmhouse, okay, now what? Then we're looking at the wash that you're talking about, 20, 25 feet from it.
Would you say we're digging the wrong place?
It appears that the spot indicated would be not in the same place where you're digging.
Two creek beds just yards apart. Fading memories over 35 years old. Kite and his team realize they will have to create yet another baseline and test pit area. Like so many UFO investigations, the Kecksburg case is plagued by a lack of on-scene eyewitnesses. Thousands of people reported the fireball in the sky. Hundreds more witnessed the commotion in the woods. But only a handful claim to have actually seen the object itself. In 1965, James Romanski was an 18-year-old volunteer fireman in Lloydsville, 11 miles from Kecksburg. He was called to his local fire hall with a report of a downed plane in the woods.
Upon arrival there at the old Kecksburg fire hall, it was wall-to-wall firemen. I mean, they were everywhere.
Romanski claims he and his fellow firefighters were ordered to search the woods for a crashed aircraft and possible survivors.
It was cold and it was damp and it was wet. We're going through the fields and the woods and everything with flashlights and that spread out 20, 30 yards apart.
Romanski and his companions approached a ravine near George Covacina's farm. The same ravine described by eyewitness Bill Bullybush.
Much to the surprise of everybody, we didn't discover an conventional aircraft as we know it. What we did find was a very large metallic object. There was no signs of windows, portholes, doors. There was no signs of wings. I have described this object in shape as a huge acorn because it had a sloped side to it and there was a bumper going the whole way around it.
Bill Bullybush, who fled the woods when he heard the firemen approaching, independently described a nearly identical object.
I could see it pretty good. There was no welding, no windows, no nothing on it. And then on the back was a ring, and it had like Egyptian writing on it, and I couldn't figure out what it was.
We might have been there at least 15 minutes. Down through the woods comes two gentlemen, very tall, very stately, overcoats on, and told us that we had to get out of there because this was now a quarantined area and to get our bus out of there and leave.
These same mysterious men in overcoats were described by several other witnesses. Bill Weaver, a teenager out for a joyride, claims he noticed them immediately.
The people that were in the plain clothes were the ones that seemed to have the authority over everyone.
You have my orders.
Only a few yards from where Bill Weaver was parked, the Hayes family, living in this cozy farmhouse, had a ringside view of the action in the woods. The family came face to face with those men in suits, along with uniformed military officers, when they arrived at their doorstep for a night the Hayes children would always remember.
I was 10 years old. Seen a lot of things that night. I could still picture the house.
The military come in, they asked about using the phone. Talked to mom and dad, told us to send us to bed.
As the December night wore on, the events in the woods would grow even more mystifying.
I think whatever it was that landed in Kecksburg was from a different planet, not Earth.
When we return, what did reporter John Murphy really see in the Kecksburg woods that night?
Then all of a sudden he turned quiet and he didn't talk about it. It just, like it never existed, never happened.
An explosive town meeting.
We seen it. We seen the military.
They lie.
And a breakthrough in the Kecksburg woods.
It does look like the top of that tree was hit by something.
Coming up on the new Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed.
The new Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed, is sponsored by Nextel Coast to Coast Walkie Talkie. Nextel, done.
New plant location?
San Diego.
San Diego?
The ocean.
The sun.
The people.
A problem.
Problem?
Prices.
Big problem. Solution?
Pittsburgh.
Pittsburgh.
Good paper.
Best paper. Pittsburgh paper.
Perfect. Pursue the potential Pittsburgh property pronto. Let's eat.
Nextel walkie-talkies get it done.
Airwick's Nightlight Scented Oils come in great scents like Plumeria and Wild Rose. And a rather fun nightlight. Nightlight Scented Oils from Airwick. This holiday, transform your home with Airwick seasonal scents and designs.
Hey, where are you off to?
Some conference in Cleveland.
Oh yeah, who with?
With Cooper.
Cooper.
Who's naughty on this plane?
This guy.
How much do you make?
Drink.
Because it's not as much as I make, I'll tell you that much right now.
Sort by shortest flights. Another way Expedia makes it easy to find the trip you're looking for.
Expedia.com.
A home, a mother, her two kids, and their pet fish. Everything was perfectly routine until someone let the cat in. Now, the whole family has gone from ordinary.
Stop this right now!
The fish is talking.
But is he saying anything?
To extraordinary. Mike Myers.
Hairball.
The Cat in the Hat. Rated PG. At theaters November 21st.
New Dentine Fire. Ruby red shell outside.
intensely cinnamon inside. It sizzles. It's cinnamon. It's new Dentine Fire. Spark something. Just got a lot more affordable.
Subaru, driven by what's inside.
Shipping durability testing. Electrostatic surge simulation. Extreme environment performance analysis. Structural integrity.
You name it, we do it. Over 11,000 hours of internal and external testing per Dell model.
Harsh.
But effective.
Right, that's why Dell is one rock solid, reliable PC.
Can you imagine?
You have no idea.
Call Dell today for great deals. Right now, a Dimension desktop with an Intel Pentium 4 processor is just $599 after mail-in rebate. Plus, for a limited time, get a free CD burner upgrade. Inspiron notebooks are just $8.99.
And now over here, the torsion chamber.
Rock solid PCs. Easy as Dell. Dell PCs use Intel Pentium 4 processors.
Extraterrestrial life does not exist.
Roswell is an urban legend.
Sightings are a figment of the imagination.
Abductions are reported by the insane.
There is no encounter of the first, second, or third kind.
You can't see the truth. You can't hear the truth. You can't speak the truth unless you know the truth. Log on to freedomofinfo.org and get the facts.
We jump into uncharted space. Limited supplies, no allies, and now no hope. As of this moment, we are at war. I promise you one thing. We will make it.
Let's get the old girl ready to roll and kick some Cylon ass.
Battlestar Galactica premieres Monday, December 8th at 9, only on Sci-Fi.
The new Roswell, Kecksburg exposed. Did a fiery object really crash? Or as some say, land in these woods back in 1965? West Virginia University archaeologist Dr. Stephen Cutler and his colleague, forestry expert Dr. Ray Hicks, begin the third day of their investigation working in a new area, since conflicting eyewitness reports place the object in either of two creek beds within about 100 feet of one another. To break the tie between these two witnesses, Kite and Hicks enlist the help of John Hayes. Hayes was 10 years old in 1965, and although he never saw the actual object, he witnessed the commotion from the window of his family's nearby farmhouse.
My bedroom was right here, and at this here corner window right here. And as you can see, I could have seen everything that was going on over here. I mean, this is all where it was happening over here. All the trucks and stuff come down through the hall of here.
Hayes also claims to have seen broken trees and evidence of a cover-up in these woods a couple of days later.
Well, they cut the fence in the hall. They didn't put it back up. I put the fence back up, and I walked on down through the hall, and I had actually seen, you know, where the treetops were broke, and where it actually hit the ground, you could see something, you know, was in the ground there, and they actually even hauled dirt down in there to cover it, everything up. It wasn't the same kind of dirt, you know, you could tell. Wood dirt and topsoil is different.
Think you can take me right to where you saw the soil had been turned up?
It's a little tough, though. It's been a while since I've been down in here. Okay, the fence line is right here. It's right in the fence line, and it's like right in here.
Okay, want to tell me where I should have my crew start digging some test holes?
I'd start right in here.
Okay, great. Now that gives us a target. The first site we dug, we picked based on Bill Bullebush's observation from a tree over there. And, you know, we are only 40 meters, maybe at most 150 feet away from where Bill thought he had seen it. So, you know, again, I think it's pretty remarkable. You guys are pretty consistent. Even more remarkably, Hayes's memories of the broken tree pattern leading up to the impact site correspond exactly with those of eyewitnesses Bill Bullebush and Jim Romanski, as well as researcher Stan Gordon's photographs from the early 80s.
Okay, the key point that I started with is that tree right there. See right. The forked cherry with the flag in it
right.
Up high?
Right.
The top of that tree was knocked out by whatever hit it.
Right, and then it was angled the whole way up through.
Okay.
From that there, straight up through there. This here tree right here, I think, was one of them that was broke off. The one that has the bird hole in it up there on the top.
Okay, yeah. Okay, it does look like the top of that tree was hit by something.
Eyewitness John Hayes has given the science team two important new clues. A more precise spot to dig for displaced soil.
See, this one's a lot darker than that. Even at the bottom, it's not as orange as that.
It does look like we may be right on John Hayes' disturbance. As well as a better trajectory for testing the broken tree hypothesis. But John Hayes has yet another memory from December of 65 that raises more disturbing questions about the incident.
My brother was with me, Jim, and there was a guy come through and he had this thing. I thought, you know, at the time, I thought it was a treasure finder, you know. He told us, you know, that we shouldn't be down in there, that, you know, that area was banned, you know, nobody's supposed to be down in there. And we told him, I said, well, we live here, you know, we're down here all the time. He said, well, you know anything about radiation? And he said, no. He said, well, there's a chance, you know, of radiation.
Rumors of radiation may help explain the curious accounts of several onlookers from the road.
There was a large truck pulled up there. There was four people got out in moon suits, we called them at the time, white suits. They had a big box on a, like a litter type thing. And the four of them carried that down in to this object down in the field. Now what they did, what they put in that box or took out of that box and worked on that object that night, I don't know.
Just as alarming as the accounts of Geiger counters and radiation suits are claims that men from shadowy government agencies also made appearances in Kecksburg that night.
At Kecksburg, there were a variety of military services that appear to have been there, Army, Air Force, possibly NASA. And then there were a variety of people who said that they saw these men in civilian suits who were running the show. So the question arises, are they men in black?
Stories of so-called men in black extend back nearly half a century. During his research of UFO crashes, journalist Nick Redfern has come across tales of these mysterious agents time and time again.
There are a number of reports on record relating to crashed UFO stories or even crashed satellite stories where witnesses to the encounters have been allegedly warned not to talk about these incidents. So there's no doubt that these men in black do exist, and at least some of them are, shall we say, from the world of officialdom.
When you have UFO witness after UFO witness claiming that they received a visit from a civilian suited person who seemed to know a lot about their encounter and who said, well, you know, it's really not such a good idea for you to talk about this because things can happen. You start to believe it after a while.
According to recovered documents resulting from the Freedom of Information Act, even the U.S. Air Force was concerned about men in black and their origins.
The Air Force had heard about these Men in Black stories and had heard that the Men in Black were disguising themselves as Air Force officers and warning members of the public not to talk about these incidents.
Get me the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd Divisions on a conference call.
And quite a lengthy memo on the Men in Black was circulated throughout the US Air Force, saying, you know, if you ever hear these stories, if you know anyone who comes across these Men in Black, let us know immediately. We need to find out who these people are, who they work for, and what they're doing.
Whether any Men in Black were actually involved in the Kecksburg crash remains to be seen. But the evidence does point to other covert agencies operating at the scene. Project Moondust and Project Bluefly.
For the most part, both of these projects were involved in the recovery of Soviet space debris, such as rocket boosters, satellites, engines, things like that. I uncovered a number of documents through the Freedom of Information Act where Moondust personnel were taking an active interest in UFO reports in the mid-1960s.
Project Moondust teams usually consisted of three specialists, experts who could ship off to any part of the world at a moment's notice and retrieve a crashed spacecraft. Whether those objects were American technology, captured foreign satellites, or of extraterrestrial origin, remains classified information. But who else was on the scene at Kecksburg that night?
Many witnesses who were involved in the event presented some good information which highly suggests that NASA played a part in the investigation that night in the Kecksburg area.
John Hayes recalls NASA personnel in his own house on the night of the crash.
I seen some guys in white coveralls. There was quite a few. When they first came in, there was probably about six of them. The one had a NASA patch on.
Were these men really from NASA? Former Air Force officer and NASA engineer James Oberg says, not likely.
If you're going to go into an area and you want to maintain security, you would usually go in under a false flag. You'd go in saying you were something else. I've heard of many cases in which groups show up in places like South America following up about some kind of meteorite or some kind of object crash, saying they're from NASA. Well, I know the people at NASA who handle that material. They get material that's mailed to them. They get phone calls, but they don't go out searching for things. That's not something they do or have ever done. So people saying they're from NASA and flashing a badge that says NASA on it is no evidence that they are in fact from NASA, and in fact it's probably evidence they're not from NASA.
Regardless of their affiliation, these men were intent on doing one thing: removing the mysterious object from the Kecksburg woods as quickly and efficiently as possible.
You know, it looked like it was practiced, like a practiced maneuver. That's exactly.
When we return to the new Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed, the Coalition for the Freedom of Information puts an undercover investigator on the Kecksburg case.
In my experience, the government can fashion any story that they want, and usually it's the story that best suits them.
The search for the missing Kecksburg records goes all the way to Capitol Hill and gains the support of one of the most influential men in America.
The records of the investigation should be released. 25 years of holding them secret was long enough.
And more updates on the Roswell crash investigation.
If it was a UFO, if it was an extraterrestrial craft capable of space travel, it probably was made of materials that we can't even begin to imagine.
The new Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed, will return in a moment.
Experience magic unlike anything you've seen before. Chris Angel, Supernatural, this Friday at 9 on Sci-Fi.
I've been having this dream every night for months. I'm convinced that there's some form of communication, and that can only mean one thing. Will I be in time to save the Earth?
Open your mind. Unlock the secret. Live the fantasy. For the first time on network television, the groundbreaking cinematic experience based on the best-selling video games, Final Fantasy, The Spirits Within, premieres this Saturday at 9 on Sci-Fi.
Dad, Dad, you know how you want to be everywhere I am? Now you can be.
Singular Family Talk. At $9.99 a line, it's an affordable, easy, and with lots of phones to choose from, cool way to keep track of your kids.
I call it my "this is so much better" plan.
$9.99 a line. Another reason Singular fits you best.
Try the Rolaids that beat Tums EX in a new taste test? It's fruity, smooth. It's Rolaids Tropical Punch. Now for a limited time in a convenient to-go pack. For fast relief, wherever you need it. Go with the great taste of Rolaids.
Now on DVD and video, own all the action, all the power, and all the adventure. The Hulk 2-disc special edition, packed with bonus material that's all the rage. Go behind the scenes for a revealing look at the amazing technology that brought the Hulk to life. Just push play and you'll be blown away. Hulk 2-disc special edition. Buy it on DVD and video today.
Imagine you could make any car you wanted. It'd have to be dependable, have a roomy, comfortable interior, and it would be worry-free for a long, long time. And it would be bulletproof, have like a jet engine and shoot lasers out of the trunk. Well, it would at least cost a lot less than any car in America. What you'd be imagining is the Kia Rio, the most affordable four-door sedan in America. Imagine that. Now get the Kia Rio starting at $8,705 after $1,500 cash back, plus $1,000 owner loyalty bonus for qualified buyers.
Somewhere between where you are and where you're going, there's a Super 8. See you along the way.
What happens when you add real flour to the unbeatable no-stick power of Pam? New Pam for baking, specially created to evenly reach every nook and cranny, so your most challenging baked goods just come out better. New Pam for baking, another reason Pam is America's favorite no-stick spray.
This is the weapon Jack uses to defeat the enemies here. Would you like to check it out? Uh-oh, here comes the Crimson Guard. Is he part of the tour? No, he's not part of the tour.
This world is better left to Jack. Rated T for team.
Let's go take care of business.
There are over 36 muscles in the human jaw. When hunger strikes, you'll be glad you have every last one of them. Triscuit. Definitely for nibblers.
Imagine having it all. The Total Choice Premiere Package from DirecTV delivers over 195 channels of our best programming, including all of our premium services, HBO, Stars, Showtime, Cinemax, and Sports Pack. Get more movies, more sports, and the maximum entertainment variety with Total Choice Premiere. Call 1-800-DIRECTV and order today.
When you think of movies, there's only one place. The most top Hollywood hits. More variety with fewer repeats than anywhere else. The ultimate in movie entertainment, Cinemax. Click or call to add Cinemax for $12 or less per month on DirecTV.
June 2003. Deep in the Pennsylvania woods, the Kecksburg science team makes some exciting discoveries. At the second dig site, there are signs of the soil disruption described by witness John Hayes.
That was actually one of the things I thought all along we would be more likely to find. Not so much the evidence of whatever fell, but whatever was done to clean up after the fall.
Yeah, this looks disturbed.
Disturbed soils are easy to discern if you have a good reference soil to compare to.
Is this enough?
Yeah. Now, we won't know exactly what happened to disturb the soil, but it's, again, a piece of the puzzle.
2,000 miles west, archaeologist Bill Dolman is trying to solve another puzzle. Roswell crash of 1947. Here, at Assegai Laboratories in Albuquerque, Dolman learns that the majority of his Humuas, historical materials of uncertain origins, have simple terrestrial explanations. There is one Humuo, however, that continues to perplex both Dr. Dolman and his team. An unexplained bundle of what at first seemed to be ordinary fibers.
At first, I thought was clearly the clippings off the nylon grid string. Then when I looked at it more closely, it didn't look like it because these fibers are not kinky.
Though Dolman ventures no opinions until further laboratory analysis, Dr. Dave Rudiak, the man who deciphered the Ramey memo, what he calls the smoking gun of last year's sci-fi Roswell investigation, has some thoughts of his own about how fibers might relate to the so-called memory metal described by so many Roswell witnesses.
A lot of people spoke of it being porous, like a fabric. You could crush it up and it would return to its original shape. In 1947, there was nothing like that. Now we know that it might be possible to build a material just like that. This Scientific American article, for example, is discussing a material called carbon nanotubules. This was discovered for the first time in about 1991.
These superfine tubules are entwined into fibers. When technology perfects them, they will be stronger than steel, lighter than aluminum, resistant to extreme heat, and totally resilient. Sound impossible? Both NASA and the military are hard at work on these miracle fibers today.
It would make a wonderful skin for a spaceship. This is more than coincidence.
If it was a UFO, if it was an extraterrestrial craft capable of space travel, probably it was made of materials that we can't even begin to imagine. And so that would be the next direction that I would go. I would say, okay, we can't figure out what the hell this thing is. Let's go talk to some material scientists and see what they think about it.
While Dolman and his colleagues plan their strategy for next year's phase of the Roswell project, the Sci-Fi Channel and the Coalition for Freedom of Information have been hitting the same stone walls in Washington that Roswell researchers have been facing for decades. Repeated attempts to uncover information about the Kecksburg incident have been turned down flat by the Department of Defense, the U.S. Army, the U.S. Air Force, and NASA.
If you're going to send out dozens and dozens of armed officials, there are records kept of such an event. So we're convinced that the records must exist someplace.
Undaunted, investigative reporter Leslie Kane has taken to the National Archives in the quest for the missing Kecksburg files.
As far as I'm aware, this effort is unprecedented. The Sci-Fi Channel is putting significant resources to bring together this professional team, which includes a law firm, an archival research firm, and the fact that we're going to take this further than most people are capable of taking it and insist that we get answers.
Another member of the team is an undercover private investigator formerly employed by the government, who's been working to uncover the identities of the mysterious military men allegedly on the scene at Kecksburg that night.
When I was in the government, I mean, I found them fairly adept at hiding information that they didn't want to disclose. If the government did want to hide the current whereabouts of some of these people, it would be fairly simple for them to do it.
If the government doesn't give up its files, Kane and the Sci-Fi Channel have enlisted the help of D.C.-based attorney Lee Helfrich to force the records to open using the legal system.
There is just no dispute that whatever you call it, the UFO phenomenon was an event or is an event that happens periodically and regularly in this country. And how the government reacted to that event is useful information because it will help explain why the government reacts to other kinds of similar events. It may not have been an alien spacecraft. It could have been a Soviet spy satellite. It could have been one of our own space experiments. Could have been any one of those things. At this point, 40 years later, we deserve to know what it is.
The coalition has gained another powerful ally in its search for the truth. President Clinton's former chief of staff, John Podesta.
It's time to find out what the truth really is that's out there.
Well, I've spent a career trying to defend the public's right to know. The records of the Kecksburg investigation should be released. 25 years of holding them secret was long enough. Certainly having the military descend on a United States town, holding people at gunpoint, is not the ordinary way we do business in this country. people should have an explanation about what triggered that sort of military response so that people can judge for themselves whether it was appropriate.
I believe that the government has the responsibility to tell everyone about Kecksburg, tell the truth about it. I think that everyone should know what went on and what crashed.
We went long enough without the answer, and I think that if the government has it, they should give it to us.
Volunteer fireman Bob Bittner is one Kecksburg resident who just wants some peace. Bittner swears on that December night, he watched military trucks descend into the ravine sometime around midnight.
I suppose they were down in there for half hour, 45 minutes, and then they all came back up out, and they stopped there. And this, the biggest truck had a tarpaulin. You couldn't see in it.
John Hayes, then 10 years old, remembers watching the same truck from his bedroom window.
There was a flatbed. It went down in empty. There was nothing on it when it went down in. But it was definitely something on when it come back out. It wasn't wasting no time when it come back out. I mean, if you'd been standing in front of it, it'd probably run you over.
Hayes wasn't the last eyewitness to see the Army trucks leave Kecksburg. Jerry Betters owned a farm in the area. The Pittsburgh jazz musician convinced some friends to drive out in hopes of seeing a UFO. Betters wasn't disappointed.
Out of these woods came this flatbed truck, Army truck. On the back of this thing was this object, acorn type shape. Maybe it was a little bigger than the Volkswagen.
Suddenly, Betters and his friends found themselves on the business ends of several soldiers' guns.
This officer came down and he shouted at these soldiers. He says, get these people out of here. They did, they cocked their guns on us.
Betters and friends were ordered to leave, not before catching a glimpse of what was under the tarp. What he still believes was a spacecraft from another world.
I could see what it was shaped like, and I could see this hieroglyphic stuff all on the back. And that's when they chased us out. There's two things I can remember very clearly. I can remember when John F. Kennedy was killed, exactly what I was doing, and I can remember this night exactly, you know.
Like so many other witnesses that night, Jerry Betters was left to wonder exactly what had been pulled from the Kecksburg woods. Former NASA engineer James Oberg has his own thoughts.
It struck me as some kind of entry of a spacecraft. And it turned out that, in fact, a Russian spacecraft had re-entered the atmosphere and hit the Earth that very day, according to official Air Force records.
Oberg is referring to Cosmos 96, a Russian Venus probe that, according to U.S. Space Command, failed and broke up over Canada early that morning. Others have argued that the object was a Russian satellite. Could either theory explain the quick arrival of the military or the possible mobilization of Project Moondust?
If a satellite is getting lower and lower in its orbit and about to re-enter, trackers for the U.S. Space Command would be watching it for days in advance, especially because we now know that the U.S. military wanted to acquire pieces of Russian satellites. A piece of a Russian spacecraft will tell you critical information, especially about their nuclear weapons.
During the Cold War, the retrieval of a Russian craft or satellite would indeed have been cause for extreme secrecy. But what about the acorn-like shape of the object recounted by so many witnesses?
The most intriguing aspect is that the re-entry capsule that the Soviets built, that which they launched toward Venus, and which fell to Earth on the same day as the Kecksburg event, somewhere else in the world, the Air Force says, is acorn-shaped.
We cannot completely rule that out, even though in 1995, when I made contact with the Russian Space Agency, they told me that there was no correlation between Cosmos 96 and what fell at Kecksburg.
A leading authority on the Soviet space program in England, Philip S. Clark, does not believe that this could have been Cosmos 96 for a number of reasons. The spherical object that would have been what came down there is only about 3 feet in diameter. It doesn't fit the descriptions of the witnesses. He does not believe that this object could have made turns, as the witnesses have reported, or have come down gradually in a slow descent.
It may have been a satellite, or it may not have been. If it wasn't a satellite, then there aren't that many other alternatives, to be honest with you, other than technology that might not have been ours.
Whatever the object was, by the next morning, there was no sign of it. But WHJB News Director John Murphy felt he had enough information to produce an explosive radio expose of the incident. Back in 1965, Linda Foscia worked as continuity director for the station.
John was extremely excited. He was putting all the cuts together for the different interviews he had had, and he just felt it was a really good program. John Murphy was really into being a top-rate newsman. That was his life.
Bonnie Milslagle, Murphy's former wife, also recalls his high hopes for the story.
This was kind of the story of his lifetime.
Although Murphy never publicly admitted seeing the object itself, his ex-wife, as well as several of his colleagues, tell a different story.
He got down there before the police were there, before any of the armed forces were there. He called me and told me he'd gotten pictures of it, but some of the film had been confiscated, but he got one rolled through.
The military was coming, and he took a picture. And he pretended that, you know, he was falling or something because he didn't want them to confiscate the camera. And there was one picture, I don't know if that was the picture or not, that he brought in. It was very dark, and it was with a lot of trees around and everything. And I don't know how far away from the site he was. But I did see a picture of a sort of a cone-like thing, or it's the only time I ever saw it.
According to Murphy's former wife and colleagues, his initial enthusiasm for the report he would call the object in the woods disappeared when he received some unexpected visits from the military.
I saw the meeting with John in the FM station, which was a little more private than his office. And what the content of their conversation was, I do not know. They did look very serious while talking with John.
There were official people coming in. He was highly upset, and then after a while, he didn't even want to talk about it. And he was so enthused, and all of a sudden, he just clammed up. He didn't want to talk. John changed, like, overnight. That was not like him at all.
The type of reporter John was, it would have been totally against his nature to totally give up a story like that. It was just too big. I think John was told that not to talk about it or report about it, and I think that's why he had a total personality change from what happened.
1 week after the incident, Murphy finally aired a radically censored version of his original report after interviewees began backing out.
Yesterday afternoon, a woman from Kecksburg area recorded for us what she saw, what she reported, and what the state police and military officers told her the object was. She described for us on tape what and how it looked. Late this afternoon, she notified this radio station that she was afraid of getting into trouble, and she did not want her description of the object used on the air. We received other calls early tonight from some other people. One person said that they was afraid of the state police, and another person said they did not want to get in trouble with the Army.
I had heard the original tape before it went on the air. I was in a little bit of a shock when I heard the end result of what had aired. There wasn't much dialogue on the tape. It was all bleeped out.
The second call came in. It was a woman with more information. We will now play that interview, and I asked you to listen closely to her description of what she saw.
Another curious feature of Murphy's report was the strange disclaimer he recited at the start of the program. Totally out of character from his usual reporting.
This station has not been contacted by any official agency of the state, federal, or local government. We have received very good cooperation with the state police and with the military, and we were able to receive all the information we wanted this past week. We have not John had any political or otherwise influence put on us concerning this program whatsoever.
I think John was trying to protect himself because he knew with the military there and everything that there was going to be problems.
Coming up, was John Murphy the man who knew too much about the Kecksburg incident?
If someone did away with John, there would be only one reason for it to have happened.
A heated town meeting in the Kecksburg firehouse attracts some witnesses who've never before come forward with their stories.
An Army Jeep pulled up and said, hey, we're having a lot of problems with people coming up into the area. If anybody should ask for directions, could you give them the wrong directions? It'd be great.
Wrong directions.
Wrong directions.
And a scientific smoking gun in the Kecksburg forest.
Something happened in 1965, something that was very abrupt that reduced the growth of the tree.
When the new Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed, returns on the Sci-Fi Channel.
We jump into uncharted space. Limited supplies, no allies, and now no hope. As of this moment, we are at war. I promise you one thing. We will make it.
Let's get the old girl ready to roll and kick some Cylon ass.
Battlestar Galactica premieres Monday, December 8th at 9, only on Sci-Fi.
Tell us everything you know about whoever it is who's out there and what the hell they want.
You went from a skeptic to a believer in a nanosecond.
Maybe I just saw the light.
They've given us electronic versions of what they have biologically.
Charlie!
Implants.
If they come for me again, I'm not going without a fight.
The inclination and speed on this thing, they're impossible.
Move to DEFCON 2.
The Emmy Award-winning Steven Spielberg presents Taken, Sunday at 9 on Sci-Fi.
Sure, I sing. And I act up now and then.
Finesse, but now try down here.
But my most important job is running this show. It's not always easy, but LifeWise products from Radio Shack are a big help. They help keep my home, my family, and me healthier and happier.
Now, discover 20 new LifeWise products and get free information on smart choices for health and home.
Hey, busy parents deserve all the help we can get.
Bye. LifeWise products, exclusively at Radio Shack.
Applebee's Take Two is back.
It takes two, baby. It takes two, baby. Make a dream come true.
Choose two of your favorite entrees for one mouth-watering plate. Eating good in the neighborhood.
At CDW, we ship over 100,000 IT products to customers every day. So how can we do it even faster? One word. Wormholes.
Need notebooks fast? Turn to HP Compact during CDW's PC event for fully loaded notebooks starting at $799 with eligible trade-in.
Now I just need to figure out that whole space-time continuum thing.
For the top brand IT products you need, when you need them, you can always expect more from CDW.
He relies on it. She relies on it. More and more people every day count on Verizon Wireless, the company that gives you America's largest, most reliable wireless network. And now you can also get unlimited night and weekend minutes to use coast to coast when on an America's Choice calling plan. Plus, get two Nokia phones for just $49.99 after mail-in rebates. So you can stay in touch with all the people you know. Verizon Wireless, we never stop working for you.
Can you hear me now? Good.
Introducing the new Clorox Bleach Pen Gel. So you can bleach what you want to bleach, and nothing more. The new Clorox Bleach Pen Gel.
Well, it's got the magic of Clorox.
New from Ricola, nature's protection with extra vitamin C. To help strengthen your immune system. Naturally.
Ricola!
He's the most innovative wrestler in the world today. Knowing no fear, knowing no limits. He is the NWA World Heavyweight Champion, He's known simply as Phenomenal. AJ Styles. See NWA TNA, Total Nonstop Action Wrestling today, only on pay-per-view.
Gentlemen, NBA League Pass is the ultimate destination for basketball action. And no matter what city you live in, NBA League Pass brings the games directly to you. Now get out there and make us proud. This is NBA League Pass.
Catch a free preview of NBA League Pass from October 29th to November 4th. To order, call 1-800-GET-SPORTS or visit DirectTV.com.
Richard, put the cookie down. Cookies are for closers only.
According to a majority of credible witnesses, something strange either flew over or landed in a patch of woods in Kecksburg, Pennsylvania, at approximately 4:45 p.m., December 9, 1965. By the next morning, the drama appeared to be over. But was it?
Well, the official explanation was that nothing happened, that there was nothing that landed, and that there was no incident, end of story.
In 1965, Bob Gatti was 22, a cub reporter for the Greensburg Tribune Review. His night editor ordered him to cover the story of the century, a real UFO crash. Upon arriving in Kecksburg, Gatti was turned back by military and state police. He was bewildered when the official explanation hit the papers.
The reason why I think the story went away, in those days, you believed what you were told by the authorities. Even reporters did.
Unlike his senior colleague, John Murphy, news director for WHJB in Greensburg, Gatti didn't witness any strange activities in the woods that night.
They knew I had been contained. Murphy had more sensitive information than I did.
According to friends and colleagues, John Murphy's life took a downward turn after the Kecksburg incident. Not long afterward, he was on assignment in California when tragedy struck.
Well, he was up in Santa Barbara, and it was around 10 o'clock at night. He wanted to go see the oil slicks. He was crossing the road.
It was deemed a hit and run. The driver was never apprehended.
I read the police report. There's too many things here that don't jive. What kind of oil slicks are you going to see at 10 o'clock at night? I didn't have any theories, but I knew something was amiss.
After Murphy's death, all his notebooks, tape recordings, photography files, and negatives simply disappeared without explanation. A man's life's work mysteriously gone.
If someone did away with John in that accident, there would be only one reason for it to have happened, and that's because he saw too much, heard too much.
Could there have been sinister forces at work in Kecksburg, making certain eyewitnesses to the events of December 9th kept quiet about what they saw? Some believers are convinced that's the motive behind the blanket denial of other residents.
Everybody was scared. Everybody was scared. Somebody said the military got to them first.
They probably were told to keep quiet from the government. The government can do anything to anybody. They can threaten you and still get away with it.
People can be gotten to, especially people that aren't big city wise. I think gotten to pretty easily and threatened in such a way that they wouldn't talk.
They had to be made to lie for some reason, either threatened or maybe they got paid.
The government doesn't have a right to cover up anything. I believe that the public and the people today should know what's going on.
Why can't someone just tell the truth? So what if it was something from outer space? It's been here 40 some years already. It hasn't hurt anybody. So, you know, tell the truth.
Who knows the truth about what really happened at Kecksburg? To try and find out, the Sci-Fi Channel decided to host an old-fashioned town meeting at the Kecksburg Fire Hall, drawing together naysayers, UFO public with their stories. So let me start with Chuck Hilland over here. Chuck, how serious are the divisions in this town over what did and didn't happen.
It's been a very fairly divisive thing for the community, and I think that's been unfortunate.
But your dad owned the land where the event that's supposedly took. What'd your dad tell you?
My parents, I must tell you, really tend to believe that nothing very significant happened.
Who had direct knowledge? Go ahead, Mr. Steiner. We haven't heard from you before.
We seen it. It was low enough that the trees were blocking part of the view of this object. I have no idea what it was.
Could have been a meteor.
Well, it originally, that's what I thought
could
it was.
Could have been space junk.
It could have been, but it was going on a steady pace.
Mm-hmm.
And it looked like it was a vehicle because it was controlled. It wasn't falling. It was just going on a level course.
So are these people making this stuff up?
I don't know.
All right, Mr. Betters, you're a young man, 65. But you say there were soldiers here. Almost two dozen.
Oh, more than that. I mean, that stopped us as a...
Why do so many people say there were no soldiers here?
I can't understand that.
Brian?
Yeah, Mike Slater, another new witness. Go ahead.
That particular night, my brother and I were actually standing on the sidewalk. An Army Jeep pulled up. I said, hey, could you guys help us out? And, of course, I'm 14 years old. He said, yeah, sure, anything we can do. We're having a lot of problem with people coming up into the area. If anybody should ask for directions, could you give them the wrong directions? It'd be great.
Give them wrong directions?
Wrong directions. So all night long, we were sending them everywhere. Not only did we see the flatbed going up empty, we saw a flatbed coming down, loaded.
And they said he went down with the truck, and they caught it out with the truck. And where this thing landed, you wouldn't have got anything bigger than a Jeep barrel.
There was three vehicles come in there, and I'll lay my hand on the Bible and tell you this.
Three military vehicles.
Right.
That's all BS.
You're saying a vehicle couldn't get down there?
No way.
Did a flatbed go up? Yes, it went up. Did it come down? Yes. And was it loaded?
Why
yes.
Do you figure so many people then say there was no military here and no, there was no flatbed truck?
Why they didn't see it? I don't know. They were so visible.
How come the newspaper accounts didn't write about that?
I'm the guy that wrote some of the newspaper stories. And I did write about the military being there. When I pulled in, I said, well, there's nothing here. Go away. So I parked my car. I walked around. I started talking to people who were on the scene, who were watching.
Well, how soon after this object landed were the military here?
Depending upon who you ask, within the hour.
Military don't track meteors and arrive that fast.
There's military, the state police, and also these people in business suits. And the people in the suits seem to have the authority and the power over the state police and the military.
Who thinks this is all a bunch of hooey? No disrespect intended.
It sounds like hooey to me, because it just does.
Well, they said the fire department was called out, too, and it wasn't.
Because you were a volunteer fireman at the time.
I was here at the time. I was the only man in the bar at the time, the only man that could answer the phone at the time. There was no call to the fire department that night.
Even though they say there was?
Even though they say there was. They lie.
I remember pulling up in front of the fire hall, and there were a bunch of people here, and they told us to get out of town. We weren't wanted up here.
So that was your sole experience with it?
No. We never went out of town. We started looking around to find out what was going on. We made it up to the top of the hill, crossed the barbed wire, and there was a military guy, Army, in his fatigues with a rifle, and stopped us right there.
This gentleman doesn't know the lay of the land up there. He doesn't know, and he probably doesn't either. How did they get the trucks in there?
Okay, but let's not talk about the trucks. He's saying that he came down here, and there were military guys who pointed a gun at him and told him to get lost.
Up there, not down
so,
here.
So something happened somewhere in the area. You'll accept that?
Well, I agree. He said he saw two military trucks up there. I'll go along with what he said.
The people who say, this is crazy, I haven't heard anybody have any explanation as to why it's crazy, other than just that it is.
And most of us all agree on one thing. And I think what a lot of us are, we want one answer, and that's basically from the military. Yes, you took something out, but they won't admit that. They won't admit presence. They won't admit that the fact that something was taken out.
You're smiling, young lady. How come?
They have the Roswell incident. I mean, the government has been covering up and lying to us for so many years. The military was here. The military does not come for stupid things.
Go ahead, Chief, and I'll let you have the last word.
28 years. I'm a fireman here at Kecksburg. It does me good as a young, old fireman now that now we know that something did happen. The military was here. Everybody here is correct in what they seen and what they heard. I think because of the lay of the land and the terrain, there was different points of vision from wherever they were at that point in time.
The outcome of our town meeting, a majority consensus that something big did happen in Kecksburg on December 9th, 1965, and that despite the official report to the contrary, soldiers were on site. More importantly, perhaps, townspeople on all sides of the debate finally had their voices heard. But another key to unlocking what really happened that night may lie deep in the woods, where Dr. Ray Hicks of West Virginia University has spent the last 2 days searching for a pattern of broken trees.
I've got some red flagging going into the woods here that indicates the pathway, I suppose, that the object apparently came from was presumably somewhere up through here. If we look up into the top of this this tree right here, you can see that it does look like it may have been broken out.
Dr. Hicks takes a core sample from a damaged tree pointed out by eyewitness John Hayes.
Right underneath that fence, it's like right on.
The rings in the core will not only tell him the age of the tree, but also when the damage to it may have occurred.
And now what I am seeing here is that right in this zone, beginning right here, in fact, there's a very distinct change in the growth rings.
This ash falls right in the center in the path of damaged trees.
We've counted from the bark of the tree back to this point where we found this dramatic slowdown in growth. And what we found was that there were 38 rings back to that point. That would indicate that whatever happened to slow that tree down happened about 1965.
1965, the same year as the Kecksburg incident. And at the very least, strong circumstantial evidence backing up eyewitness reports that an object did crash through these trees.
The damage that Ray identified formed a pattern. It formed a clear trajectory. It is a reasonable trajectory from some of the other observations that were made. And the real nice thing about it, it has a date to it, 1965. And since there is obvious visible damage, that is a smoking gun, so to speak, as to what caused the decrease in growth in that individual tree.
When we return, some last words about the Kecksburg mystery. And the Sci-Fi Channel takes on an explosive new investigation into the world's best documented UFO case.
I saw what I saw, and I can't take that out of my mind.
The New Roswell, Kecksburg Exposed, is sponsored by Sonicare Elite. Stop brushing, start Sonicare.
The new Sonicare Elite by Philips. With patented sonic technology, its bristle tips move 3 times faster for a deep cleaning experience unlike any other.
For whiter teeth and healthier gums,
stop brushing. Start Sonicare.
Action!
Remember, when you hit the water,
I need you to hydroplane out of control.
Water!
Remember, out of control.
Cut!
No, cut!
Cut.
Fire the stunt driver.
The new Michelin Hydro Edge with patented hydro chutes. It's our best performing tire in its class. Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
Mike, Sue.
Yes.
Love and honor.
Yep.
Sickness, health.
Uh-huh.
Objections? Rings? Do you?
I do.
Do you?
I do.
Kiss? Husband and wife. Next.
Next on Walkie Talkies, get it done.
Somewhere between where you are and where you're going, there's a Super 8. See you along the way.
I just don't get the whole megapixel thing with digital cameras.
Basically, the more megapixels, the sharper the picture.
You know, you should check out the cameras at Gateway. Their new 5-megapixel is under $250. That's film quality prints at a killer price.
That sounds really nice. Everything should be so nice.
I took your wallet. Sorry.
This is the way things should be. And that's how they are at Gateway. 50 new products. 3 ways to Gateway.
Jared? What are you doing here?
I don't know. I've always wanted to try this place.
But Jared, it's okay. I had Subway for lunch.
When you have wholesome low-fat sandwiches from Subway, it's all right to indulge now and then. Try our delicious sweet onion chicken teriyaki sandwich, made fresh with under 6 grams of fat, so you can feel good about being good and okay about being bad.
Some dessert, sir?
Subway, good, so you don't always have to be.
Get ready for the DVD event of the year.
Let's head in.
Unleash the beast. Unleash the excitement. Unleash the power that's too big for one DVD.
My God.
The Hulk 2-disc special edition. Unleash the great special effects secrets and go behind the scenes for a revealing look at the amazing technology that brought the Hulk to life. Just push play and you'll be blown away. Hulk. Buy it on DVD and video today. This Friday, Scare Tactics goes to the horror movies with an all-new special. Hosted by Shannon Doherty from Universal Studios. Halloween on Sci-Fi. The Scare Tactics Scare-tacular. This Friday at 10.
The city may be lost, but we are not. Let's do this thing and get the hell out of here.
For the first time on network television, based on the best-selling video games, Final Fantasy, The Spirits Within, premieres this Saturday at 9 on Sci-Fi. Tonight on Sci-Fi, at 11, Devil's Prey. At 1, Crossing Over with John Edward. And at 1:30, The Twilight Zone.
Roswell and Kecksburg have been the focus of just 2 of the Sci-Fi Channel's declassified investigations into modern UFO mysteries. In the coming months, Sci-Fi will keep you posted with regular updates from both New Mexico and Pennsylvania. And in an upcoming investigation, take you across the Atlantic for an inquiry into the world's only officially recognized UFO encounter.
I saw what I saw, and I can't take that out of my mind.
December 1980. The airspace of a U.S. military base is invaded by UFOs over several nights.
I was thinking at the time, is this a warning? Is this an attempt to communicate?
Among the dozens of witnesses, high-ranking Air Force officers.
These are military people trained to observe.
Once sworn to secrecy, they're now ready to talk.
I walked around it. I felt it.
A cover-up begins. Amid claims of brainwashing and intimidation.
They said bullets are cheap.
But the cover-up can't stop civilians from coming forward to corroborate the sightings.
It was gone. It was just incredible, wasn't it?
It was too long.
A top-secret memo confirming the events unleashes a firestorm.
This was an official United States Air Force document talking about a structured metallic craft.
And amazingly, part of the encounter is captured on audio tape. Now, for the first time ever, the Sci-Fi Channel brings together eyewitnesses and scientists to investigate the case. And new witnesses go on record for the first time.
It was like a pulsating eye.
The truth about what happened in Rendlesham Forest.
The Rendlesham Forest incident is bigger than Roswell.
Could well change what you believe about UFOs.
This here is an official U.S. Air Force investigation, and we got put in a world of shit.
It's coming this way. Awesome. It is definitely coming this way.
The Sci-Fi Channel's investigation into the Kecksburg case has broken new ground on a number of fronts. In the science department, core dating within a line of damaged trees prove that something traumatic happened there in 1965, corroborating eyewitness accounts of a crash on that very spot. In the legal arena, the lost Kecksburg files are coming closer to resurfacing, thanks to work by the Sci-Fi Channel and the Coalition for Freedom of Information in Washington. Finally, in the town of Kecksburg itself, there is new hope for some long-awaited answers to questions that have lingered since December of 65. I'm Bryant Gumbel. Thank you for joining us.
Go to sci-fi.com for the complete unedited Kecksburg Town Meeting moderated by Bryant Gumbel.
This fall semester, your only course requirement is to stay alive. Urban Legend, The Faculty, Thursday at 7 on Sci-Fi.
Is this going to be on the test?
This is the test.
Absolute evil does exist. It's just been waiting.
The time is come.
This Halloween, prepare to unleash your darkest fantasies.
My God.
The Halloween Movie Marathon, this Friday, all day, on Sci-Fi.
Next on Sci-Fi, Devil's Prey.